It's time for the Spirit Campfire, starring Ted Nugent and John Brinkus. It's the show about the physics of spirituality with attitude.
Wow. Hello, everybody.
Yowza! The Spirit Campfire. Let me get this right. If you take care of your mind, body, and spirit and soul, Spirit Campfire in your belly and be able to share it with the world all around you, and positive energy will erupt like flames from my butt where you can cook spiritual marshmallows to burn. Are you all with me?
Are you with me? Are you with Uncle Ted? How is everybody? We are gathered around the campfire, and tonight's show is going to be truly special. Ted, we are going to have a little bit of a country theme tonight. I asked you if you'd be willing to play something on an acoustic guitar, country style, and you were like, I don't know, man.
I don't know. You know, I got this huge Motor City scrotum that only does rhythm and blues and rock and roll. And if I mistreat it, it'll swing Heather and Jan and take down small animals. And I better stick with my calling. God called me. He said, Uncle Ted, I want you to play animal breeding, rhythm and blues, rock and roll. I want you to follow in the footsteps, the fiery footsteps of James Brown and Wilson Pickett and Sam and Dave and the Motown. Like Howlin' Wolf and Muddy Waters and Lightnin' Hopkins and B.B. King, Freddie King and Albert King and Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley. But most of all, Uncle Ted, I want you to unleash the little Richard within you. So I wrote Wang Dang Sweet Poon Tang, and the world has been a better place since. Something like that. So that's as close to country as I can get. And already my dogs are behind me humping inanimate objects.
That's right. Because when they hear that I don't know what happened with that song. By the way, for our audience, what is the origin of that song? Like when you sat around thinking about the title for that song, that title finished first. What finished second?
Well, first of all, John, I've never in my life, I started playing when I was, barely able to walk. My aunt gave me this wrecked guitar that she, as an airline stewardess, she brought off the airline that nobody claimed. And, Elvis was already happening. Chuck and Bo were already creating this throbbing, rattling, infectious, inescapable, grinding soundtrack. And all of us, you interview anybody who was born in the late 50s and early 60s, and they will reference the pounding, the jackhammer of this uppity, outrageous, freedom, defiant, uncharted soundtrack that Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley and Little Richard and Jerry Lee Lewis and all these founding fathers created. So when lucky for me, because I've been a bow hunter all my life and I got to pay really close attention to my surroundings or I'll have to buy chicken. And I don't buy chicken, by the way. I've shot a couple. But anyhow, that song is a reflective of what I've celebrated in the past. Never in my life have I sat down and gone, gee, what should I write about today? I grab my guitar, every song I've ever channeled. I'm like, what did I tell you last time? I said, lobster is the delivery vehicle for butter. Well, I'm merely the delivery vehicle for sexy, grinding, animal soundtrack. So I've never thought about a title. You know, when I start a lick, I start a song. And when you go, plus, there's a little Wang Dang history in, I think, either Muddy Waters or Mose Allison, where they had a song called Wang Dang Doodle, which I'm sure was the celebration of beautiful, attractive, stimulating members of the opposite sex, whatever that sex you choose. And so I've never really thought about lyrics or the sound. When I pick up a guitar every day, these killer grinding sons and an offspring of Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley, Little Richard, those guys that still imprint on me to this day. And the lick with a damn, 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 damn. I mean, what are you going to say to that about cat scratch beaver? Unless you're in at a golf course, then you can't trap beaver. But what I do is I just let the the organic groove and the chord patterns dictate a syllable series that turns me on. And I know you, John, the title,
right?
Sweet Poontang, it's your favorite song. I know
it is my favorite song. So I just want to translate this for you. What you're saying is there was no second place. God intervened. You just started playing a lick, and the first thing to come out of your mouth just became the title of the song.
Wang Dang with a sweet, Poontang shaking that thing like a rang a dang a dang in the bell. She's so sweet when she gobbles my meat. She can't be beat. What the hell? So yeah, this is love song. I don't know. It's like naturally love songs just come forth from me, and I'm sure you can feel the love, which is why you have a lovely smile on your face.
I do. It is a love song. It's a great American love ballad, which is incredible. So on our little campfire, not little, nothing is little with Ted Nugent.
Little, so let me rephrase that.
I've got to learn this. Every time that I say to Ted, hey, would you do a little? He says, yes, but nothing is little. Nothing is little.
I don't do a little bit of fishing. I don't do a little bit of rock and roll. That's the word gonzo. I'd like to think, John, that the reason you moved into my spirit atmosphere, and that the reason there's a John Brankus and Ted Nugent shared adventurous physics of spirituality with attitude, is because the term gonzo means go for it. You know, we talk about the man in the arena. The man in the arena doesn't do anything little. He goes gonzo. So the term gonzo represents our absolute dedication of mind, spirit, body, and soul into any given endeavor, whether it's your career,
that's right,
playtime, conservation, politics, you know, demanding accountability from our elected employees, you know, radical stuff like that. I think the battle cry of being the absolute best you can be. Gonzo is the rock and roll version of the word samurai.
Yes. All right. Now, listen, we have a huge show tonight. So everybody who's out there, buckle up, because we have guest after guest after guest, an incredible lineup. If you want to ask Ted or any of our guests a question, you can leave it in the comment section, or you can also click the Zoom link that we've included. We're going to bring in our first guest, who has been third leg to our stool.
Yeah.
It's the one and the only Omar Crispy Avila.
Welcome back. Did that sound good? I love you, Crispy. You are my crispy critter.
Where's Crispy?
Thank you. I'm right here.
Did you like my accent? Was it any good? It was pretty lame, I thought.
I liked it, you know. I mean, you ain't from Texas, so you really can't say it, but it's okay.
That's good. How is everything going in the world of Crispy tonight?
It's good. I was just telling the guys, I jumped in a little late. We had a family view, and one of my cousins passed away from COVID. And
So sorry, Crispy.
We are so sorry. Uh-oh. Crispy got muted somehow.
I think he's all of a sudden winning.
I think Crispy got muted somehow.
Yeah.
Hey, Crispy, are you back? There you are.
Yeah.
Let me tell you that we all send our prayers to you and your family to fortify your spirit and call all the positives that your lost brother has provided you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And everybody, please, out there, regardless of your religion, let's all attack it from every angle and pray for Crispy and pray for everybody. You know, COVID, you know, is as much as it's been dominating the news cycle, it's very real. And now, you know, the number of people who know somebody who's passed away from it, you know, just keeps growing and growing. So Crispy, we will definitely all be praying for you and your family.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
We absolutely will.
John, you know, a lot of families are hurting out there. I'm in communication with people every day, not just walking the streets of Texas, keeping in touch with my friends in all 50 states, but on Facebook. And people really are hurting out there. So the Nugent family responded way back in February with how are we going to react to this Chinese communist virus, and that is to pray even more for our fellow human beings that are going to hurt right now. So, and especially in these moments of upheaval, we pray for individuals, we pray for families, but we pray for the United States of America as a dream. So keep those prayers going. We can have fun and we can go crazy and be silly, but at the end of the day, prayers make a difference.
Absolutely. I mean, and prayer works. I mean, you know, people refer to prayer in different ways. It could be meditation. It could just be visualization. Whatever it is, prayer works. Positive energy begets positive energy. And this campfire is nothing but positive energy. That's why we started this fire, is just to keep spreading the positive energy. So,
and John, I told comment on that prayer thing, because I think I bring a perspective that when I share this perspective with people, I see wheels start to turn. And yes, you can do your religious prayers, how you were raised in whatever religion that you were brought up in. And those prayers are real when you put your, and you're sincere about it. But let me tell you a prayer that those who may be not a member of an organized religion, which there's a lot of us out there, you know, just the way you conduct yourself every day.
Yeah.
You're friendly, yeah, and you watch for people in need, and you reach out to those people, whether it's charity work, just a neighbor who might need some help. Up north, I used to drive all over the county and find these, yeah, these farm gals that had snow, and I'd take my Bronco and plow their snow. I think that was a prayer. I think,
oh, absolutely,
on the street, wave and say hello. Conduct may be the most powerful prayer of all, because it has immediate, tangible gratification.
Absolutely.
Share that just
Ted, what's amazing is, so I've been Catholic my whole life, and my parents did not send me to Catholic school because they just wanted me to have a more diverse experience. And I had an incredible upbringing with religion and the way that I certainly relate to the universe. And that is that there is no one right religion, that people relate to the universe in all kinds of different ways. And, you know, we're all in touch with that positive spirit. But one of the best things that I've ever heard somebody say, and this was a priest for back home, but I was raised in Vienna, Virginia. He said, "May your actions be your prayers." And I just thought that was the perfect thing.
Cloth actually understood what I just naturally, instinctively understood that. But a man who actually studied spirituality, I would hope, and certainly religion. So there we have confirmation that I can not only write Wang Dang Sweet Poon Tang, but I can embrace some very important physical and spiritual gestures, or indeed prayers.
All right. So listen, told you that we were going to have a country, little bit of a country bent. We've got Crispy on with his hat in Texas. And so I'm going to qualify that as a little bit of country, but we're going to bring on another special guest right now. I'm going to qualify that as a little bit of country. We're going to bring on a very special friend, Herbert. I think that we've got Tim Montana in our room tonight, because he is an amazing country artist. Tim, are you there for us?
Good morning, San Diego.
Tim, greetings. Welcome to the campfire, man. Glad to have you. Proud to have you here, Tim.
I brought Wayne.
Nice to meet you, Tim.
Nice to meet you, Omar. I heard a lot about you, all bad, but, you know, work through that.
That's right. Hey, so Tim, not only are you an amazing artist, Ted, Tim wrote an amazing song called Quarantine that went viral during the quarantine.
I saw that.
He also has an amazing story. He actually had a connection with you a few years ago. What, Tim, you told me to cue you up on this story.
Yeah. It was about 10 years ago. I was working with a late friend of mine and yours named Mr. Blue Miller from Detroit.
Oh, yeah. Killer guitar player.
Oh, yeah. Played for Bob Seger and Isaac Hayes and just fantastic human. And he brought me backstage at the Wild Horse because I really wanted to meet you. And I remember you were hemming and hawing because they wouldn't let you shoot a flaming arrow on the Wild Horse.
Yes, indeed. Story of my life.
Yeah. You went to slam the door before you did. You said, "Montana, take some effing notes." And I was just like, "Oh my God." And then I got out in the crowd, and during the middle of the set, you ripped a solo and you're like, "There's this kid from Montana out here tonight, and this one's for you." I almost passed out, and that was an incredible night. So 10 years later,
I remember I played some licks that I almost passed out. I remember them distinctly. Yeah. Blue Miller was a Motor City guitar player, and everybody knows that, man, what happens in Detroit, everybody reveres that. And I think it's due to the Motown Funk Brothers, the incredible authority of those Motown virtuosos, rubbed off on all of us, from Mitch Ryder, the Detroit Fields, and certainly Seeger, and Blue Moon in Brownsville Station, and the MC5, and even today with Eminem and Kid Rock. So we're real proud of that Detroit legacy, and I try to honor it every day.
All right, so listen, one of the reasons why I connected with Tim Montana so well is, first of all, stand-up guy, amazing musician, really very, very patriotic. And he works with some incredible, incredible musicians. But Ted, I wanted to actually give you a taste of Tim Montana's music. So I'm going to cue up the title track to his latest album. And I think it's something that you're really going to like because it's all about America. This is called American Thread by Tim Montana. And this just tells you that, look, country music is out there taking the pulse of the people. And here he is, the one and only talented Tim Montana.
Tough as nails, hard as bricks, 6 foot one, walking 10 foot six, four on the floor, 12 in the back, with a weather god box in an old gun rack. Feeling fly, riding high, rough neck red till the day we die. With the 18 wheelers, hauling loads up at dawn.
That part was really good, I swear.
Unmute! Unmute! Somebody unmute that microphone!
John, you unmute your microphone. John! There we go.
With the dust of boots and late night rides, busted knuckles and bloodshot eyes, might break our backs, but not our pride. Saving lives from the teachers and the preachers trying to raise them right. From the third shift hustle to the 9 to 5. To the single mom trying to feed her kids. To the bartender tending on making tips. We're all one people at the end of the day. No matter where we're from, we're American made.
Now, let me just tell you something. That's a guy you can hang out with.
I'll tell you, let me go ahead and comment on my country blood brother, because that was more rock and roll and rhythm and blues than traditional country. So I salute him. I think it'd be interesting when you create a killer song with that kind of imagery and those kind of lyrics that just hit to the core, certainly of everybody I hang out with and the real hell raisers and shit kickers of this country. I think people would like to know a little bit about you. For starters, I want to salute you, because the guitar solo was at the proper level as a lead vocal where it belongs. Because a lot of these new country bands, the guitar solo starts and it's buried under the keyboard. And I'm going to have to assassinate somebody if that keeps up.
Before Tim Montana answers, we got some comments on Facebook that some people were having trouble with the Facebook feed. Make sure you go. You can also just go to YouTube, search Ted's YouTube page. You can find a clean stream. It's working great there. You can also go to Grunt Style, G-R-U-N-T Style. Grunt Style is one of the sponsors tonight for the show. On their Facebook page or YouTube, you can see it there. Also on Killcliff, who's another sponsor, you can go there. It's being streamed all over the place. You can go to Tim Montana's page as well. So you definitely can find a clean feed of the program. So Tim, answer Mr. Nugent here, which is a pretty big compliment for a guy going into this. Was trying to put down country music, because that's a badass song.
Yeah, well, I tease my country fans because they deserve it. But that's a great song, Tim. So, first of all, is that you playing the guitar solo?
That is Mr. Derek Wells playing the guitar solo.
God bless Mr. Derek Wells. You give him a big, give him an extra dog biscuit for me, would you? Because I love that kind of grease factor. So, Tim, first of all, where are you from and how long have you been doing this kind of stuff?
I was born and raised in Montana, grew up off the grid till I was 18, way in the backcountry up there. And I've been in Nashville about 15 years. And met our mutual friend, Bobby Ritchie, and wrote a couple songs for his last record. Bob and Audrey are good friends, and just Rob O'Neill, and just surrounded by a lot of people that know you. And met a lot of good people, man, that have taken me under their wing and helped me out. So
very well, good for you. It's good stuff.
You're welcome.
Good quality, passionate stuff. Being in the off the grid in Montana, what part of the state did you grow up in?
We started north of Kalispell, a little community called Kyla, Montana, and then we ended up north of Butte, which is my favorite spot.
Boy, that's God's country, man. They're just the spirit of that wild is highly influential and highly inspiring. I used to hunt out at Grass Range for a number of years, you know, for the pronghorn and the mule deer, and the pheasants were just amazing. So congratulations on that, Tim. That's really quality, passionate, real American hell-raising music. God bless you.
Thanks.
Yep.
So listen, Tim is, first of all, amazing musician, amazing friend. I mean, literally, every time I've called Tim Montana and said, hey, can you help us out? He was part of Salute Across America. Ted, if you remember that. I mean, literally, he's the kind of guy that will drop everything. First time he was ever on our show, he's in the middle of Tennessee on his cell phone. He's like, yeah, I'll do anything, man. So he introduced us to a couple of people who actually tour with him, Molly Brown and Tom Samulak. And Herbert, let's cue them up and let's introduce Molly and Tom. Hey, there they are. Is Molly and Tom, are you guys there?
Hello. Hey, what's up? Hi, everybody.
It's Molly and Tom. Are you guys both in the same room? Are you together there today?
Indeed.
Good. Well, welcome to the camper. We're proud to have you here.
I'm so excited to be here.
Glad to be here.
So what we wanted to do here was to have Molly is like literally has a voice from heaven. Tom is an unbelievable musician. And I said to them, they were driving back from Canada, I believe, down to Nashville. And I said, hey, why don't you guys do a cover of a Ted Nugent song, country style? And here's what they came up with.
Must have been a way that you touched me. Could have been a way that you looked. Must have been a way that you loved me. Could have been a way that you caught. But I need you. I need you bad. Yeah, I need you. I need you bad. I'm in pain when you're not around me. I'm in pain when you're not around me. You and I need you. I need you. Must have been true desperation. Could have been a feeling inside. Maybe I was just getting lonely. Got a feeling I just can't hide. But I need you. I need you back. I need you back. I'm in pain when you're not around me. I'm in pain when you're not around you. And I need you. Yeah, I need you bad. I'm in pain when you're not around me. I'm in pain when I'm not around you. I need you back. Oh, I need you. I need you back.
Now, I got to tell you, boy, that makes me, my face actually hurts from smiling so much. Molly, that's way sexier than my version.
Oh.
We got a little Aretha Franklin Motown thing going on there. That was Charlie Hune from Grand Rapids, Michigan, who sang the lead vocal on that song. And John Souter on the bass guitar and Cliff Davies on drums. It was a great, great session, but I'm glad you picked that song. You did a great job. I'm very honored.
Oh my goodness. Well, we're honored to play it. We know that you've got so many Motown influences, and that's kind of just like the birthplace of rock and roll. So I thought, why not?
Well, God bless you guys. Nicely done. Nice guitar tone. Is that a Telecaster?
Oh yeah.
Beautiful. It's got the grease. We love the grease. Nicely done, guys. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That it's pretty incredible. Now listen, Molly and Tom, I want you guys to you guys have that song down. I want you to go learn another one. And we're gonna bring you back. Because we got another special guest to bring on. We have a packed show.
You got it.
All right. So Ted, tonight we're being sponsored by Killcliff. So we want everybody to go to killcliff.com. We also are being sponsored by Grunt Style. And we have the one and only Tim Jensen from Grunt Style. Tim, are you here with us?
Wang dang, sweet poo tang. I sure am, my friends.
You're speaking my language there, Grunt.
How's it going?
So, everything's great. So first of all, we love Grunt Style. For those who aren't familiar with it, Grunt Style was part of Salute Across America. But Tim, why don't you tell us about Grunt Style? Because Ted and his audience, I know that they're products that, you know, they will absolutely love.
Right on. So, Grunt Style is a better known, operated lifestyle pair brand that really focuses in, veterans inspired designs as well as patriotic designs. And we really exist to know, celebrate, and defend the Constitution of the United States. And the great thing is you don't have to be a veteran to wear it, but you do have to love your country.
That would make us a veteran of constitutional patriotism. I think all good Americans qualify. Well, congratulations for that. We're proud to have you guys here. You give our very best to all those vets. You know that we fight every day, most importantly, fighting for those freedoms and those constitutional rights that your buddies didn't make at home because they were willing to make the ultimate sacrifice. We always remind everybody, freedom ain't free. So God bless all those warriors.
Hey, Omar, Crispy, I need you to judge whose beard is better between Tim and Tim.
I'm gonna be biased because I've slept next to Tim before, Montana, and his beard just smelled like whiskey and dip and cigar, and I gotta go with Tim Montana, but I gotta go smell Tim's as well in San Antonio, and then maybe we can come back to this and we can do this again.
And those are great beards. I got to tell you, we salute the bearded wonders out there. I keep in touch with Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top, the man of beards. But let me just warn you, gentlemen, not just because you respect your elders, but we're going to do the new Brankus Spirit Campfire come this winter. And by January, early February, I will have the killer gold silver beard. I have my beard is like Santa Claus, man. It's awesome. And I grow, my hair that stays brown. But my beard and everything turns just silver. It's so handsome, I can hardly stand myself. So brown beards are cool, but I'm going to trump you with a great, great grandpa beard come January.
There you go. Yeah, it shows wisdom.
It does. It shows wisdom. And I need someone to explain to me why I cannot grow a beard. Because I've tried, and somehow my whiskers come out, and then they just stop. And
You need to start
exactly
hunting.
It's because I don't hunt.
And then it starts.
I'll tell you, there's two things that'll help that. Number one, get downwind of my amplifiers during a and you'll look like a Sasquatch in about 20 minutes if you pay attention. I share a campfire, hopefully with Tim and the great Cornholia and Omar and I. You get enough of that sacred backstrapping system, all of a sudden, the beast comes out.
It's like you grow three times larger.
Yep,
that's right. Hey, Tim Montana, I know you had a pretty good hunting story that you were telling me. I said, listen, I know Ted likes to when we're sitting around the campfire, we want to exchange some hunting stories. And since I'm not bringing any hunting, I can only bring spearfishing stories. You said you had a pretty good one.
Well, I have one probably 11 years old, just north of Butte, Montana. Can you hear me? I was with a stepdad and his buddy that was this one-eyed guy, I think. And we hiked in this Buffalo Gulch for probably 6-7 miles. And it was almost dusk, and this, I think, 5x4 bull out there. and he took the shot. And then I was excited and like was going to go run right out to the elk. And then the one-eyed guy fired his 270 right over the top of my shoulder. And I was like, Jesus Christ. But so then, of course, I had this old school metal frame like hiking backpack from a pawn shop or something. So we quartered this elk out and put the elk in my bag because I was the 11-year-old. You know, I had to earn the meat that I was carrying out. So I take off hiking and I'm like, well, I'm going to beat all the old guys back to camp. And I go to jump over this little creek and fall backwards into it with this backpack strapped on that is now holding me underwater in this freezing cold water. And I kind of sat there like, am I the dumbass that's going to die with this elk on my back? Somehow I was able to get the strap off and roll out. And now I'm wet, freezing, and getting the elk out. And that was one of my first, like, real experiences hunting. And I was like, oh, this is, like, real stuff. This is just sitting in a tree stand like a lot of guys do. This is, like, wow, life and death stuff. But it was pretty eye-opening experience. So I like the edgy hunting like that.
Well, Tim, I will tell you, I may be the only guy that can tell you this, but you know what that is that you experience? You know what that's called officially? Only in my world of omniscience do we understand, but you were just Wapiti baptized. The Wapiti is the native term for elk, and I think the elk got his lick and he was trying to get even and drown your ass. Congratulations for making it out of there. We're glad you survived your first elk baptism.
Yeah, pretty amazing. Well, listen, Tim Jensen, I know that you had to run with us because Molly and Tom have another song, but I wanted you to make us aware. Grunt Style has some incredible initiatives going on. And you had that competition that you guys that we were talking about before the show. I want you to share everything with the audience.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So, you know, Grunt Style's, you know, we live in some pretty interesting times right now. I think we all see it on television. You know, we escaped to these beautiful settings at the Spirit Campfire and other places to kind of remove ourselves from that. But it doesn't change the fact that, you know, it's a crazy world. And, you know, Grunt Style, you know, some of the things that we're getting behind that we think is really important, that, you know, we hope that it sparks some opportunities and engagement with the people at home, is we're getting, we're doing a lot of work with the Boys and Girls Club here in San Antonio and the state of Texas, as well as the Habitat for Humanity. So we're really getting involved in a more of a community aspect, and you know, really putting a lot of attention there, because as we all know, the only change that can really happens at that local level, and you have to manufacture that change. So we're pretty excited about that. And something, Ted, that I think that you would find pretty interesting, sir, is we're getting ready to gear up for our Man the Sniper Challenge that will be held at Fort Gordon in January of next year. It's one of the only long-range sniper competitions that's held on a military installation. And we're pretty excited about that. We got some really big partners that could be coming online this year. And as always, Vortex, one of our biggest partners. And I know that you're great friends with them, Ted, and they've done some really great things with helping with the sniper competition. So a lot of cool stuff, and, you know, great things that the company's involved in. And always, you know, very happy to work alongside you. When John had reached out and asked if we wanted to be a part, I said, absolutely. A Salute Across America was absolutely fantastic. Did such an amazing thing. And what you guys are doing here with the Spirit Campfire is much of the same, and really a breath of fresh air when there's nothing but negativity flowing around.
Well, good for you. I'm going to keep that in mind, because I really enjoy the challenge of really long range sniping. I've got a George Gardner GA Precision.
Oh yeah, I know George very well.
John stands for Nat's ass, because GA Precision rifles, if you can't hit a Nat's ass at 1,000 yards, you're not doing a good trigger work. So I would encourage those listening, a lot of people that join us at the Spirit Campfire, obviously because Uncle Ballistic Ted is part of it, but I cannot overstate, and I'm sure Tim and everybody will concur, that the marksmanship discipline is a very rewarding samurai higher level awareness. So if you've never tried, if you've never had a good quality deer rifle or a long range rifle, and of course you can start off at short range, you start hitting bullseyes at 100 yards, then you know you have your sight acquisition down, your sight picture, your breathing, your trigger control. It's really a what I call a ballistic ballet. And we have a Ted Nugent Camp for Kids for 31 years, and we've trained thousands and thousands of boys and girls from 7 to 17 with marksmanship, firearm safety, and discipline. So anybody here at the Spirit Campfire that's not a gun guy, not delved into the world of sniping and marksmanship discipline, I'm going to tell you, it's not just about shooting stuff. It's not just about self-defense. It's just not about tactics and saving your country. It can also be just family weekend of attaining a higher level of awareness when you get your left hand and your right hand to work as a single element, and you get the breathing down so that that little movement of the crosshairs gets smaller and smaller. You let that breath out halfway, and you become one with the imprint of your muscle memory on that trigger. And when that gun goes off, it when you're doing it right, much like archery, and I suspect a lot of killer sports, but with marksmanship, there's a primal instinct to have a weapon capability that can determine life and death. But beyond the critical life and death performance of a firearm and your familiarity and capabilities with it, it's just fun. It's fun to hit that can at 100, right, 200 yards, to get that steel plate 400 and 500 yards, to get that the 308 ballistics, the 7.62 by 5.1, or you get a 5.56 caliber you choose. Any good deer rifle will suffice to learn that marksmanship ballet. But anybody watching right now with Uncle Ted and John and our crew here, get yourself a quality bolt rifle in a caliber that's comfortable for you. You can go right down to 223 or a 243 or a 708. Get something light recoil and not harsh on a newcomer. But I'm going to tell you, once you learn that marksmanship discipline, you will go back and you will try longer range, smaller targets. You'll get somebody to call the wind and the mirage. There's a science to sniper accuracy that becomes quite consuming. I think it's as intense as any golf or baseball or basketball or hockey or archery. I think firearms oneness is one of the great gratifying procedures that is available uniquely here in America. So if there isn't a gun guy out there, become one. You will be very happy to get it.
Absolutely. Real quick, you know, I think what you're saying, there's a lot of value there. You know, I came back from Iraq in 2005, having picked up a weapon, you know, it was almost 12 years. When I came back, Ted, you were there. I was with the 24th MU. You came to Camp Pendleton. You and I shot rifles together. It was an extraordinary moment. It was a lot of fun. But after that moment, it took me well over 10 years to ever pick up a rifle again and just even participate in target shooting. And then when I did, you know, I was, you know, brought to a range by a friend of mine and got back in to shooting rifles. And, you know, it just brings back that, like you said, that laser focus mentality to where, you know, much like any other sport, what makes it a sport is that you're putting singularity to something that you're doing. And there's a lot of value in that, a lot of clarity, a lot of just engagement from, you know, a lot of mental synapses that are happening in your head. So it's widely therapeutic. And, you know, it's something that I think every one of us as Americans should practice, because it is in our Constitution. It is something that we should be familiar with and comfortable with, and one, most importantly, be responsible.
Totally. You know what he's talking about there, John, I've had the experience from the very baptismal introductory level child with a pellet gun or a bolt action 22 that sometimes they're a little spooked by it. They're uncomfortable with it. But once they get past, when you have ears and eyes on, your hearing protection, your eye protection, and you get the proper training, that I'm telling you, these kids will never be excited about this crap ever again. If they can bust a tin can with their 22 rifle and on a weekend with their parents, now you take it from that introductory level to the masters of the military who are trained completely with firearms knowledge, comfort and mastery. When they come back from the hell of war, I have found that a lot of them intentionally distance themselves from that stuff. And once they get past the fog of war, some have none, some have extremes. But when they get back to that familiar hand-eye breathing coordination of marksmanship fun, it has no relationship whatsoever to maybe the trauma that may have existed and the pain and suffering they witnessed and the confusion that goes in the fog of war. I know I'm speaking out of line here to degree because I've been there, but I've never been an official military guy. But I've been able to be in the fog of war with the guys in Fallujah, for example, in 04 when there was ultra fog. And I find that what Tim said, it is terminally therapeutic. Once you get that trigger and you're trying to get those crosshairs to settle down, there's no bad memories. It cleanses the soul. So anybody that hasn't been trained in that, meet somebody at the gun shop. I know you know people with guns no matter where you are in this country, and be familiar and comfortable with them. It really will, it'll force you to be more aware of your surroundings, conditional situational awareness, and it will serve you well in any endeavor you pursue. So that's a little Uncle Ted tech tip with an authentication from the warriors of the military that know what I'm saying is
exactly. So, hey, Crispy and Tim Montana. Crispy, I really love hearing you share how much it means to you when you're hunting and you're out there in nature, but also just sort of how zen and therapeutic it is for you to be one with, you know, nature, and also, you know, how responsible of a hunt, you know, a responsible hunter is only killing an animal that they're then going to eat. And for you, it's just so therapeutic. I love hearing your thoughts on that. I'd love to hear it from you, Tim, because I know you're a big hunter as well. Crispy, what are your thoughts? Oh, you're muted, I think.
Oh, I win. He's muted.
Unmute Crispy. Well, what we've got here, I got to tell you, what we've got here, God, you're surrounded. Hey, Molly, are you a hunter at all? Molly, you ever been out in the woods?
I have never personally been hunting. I went shed hunting all this spring in Ontario.
There you go.
Are you Canadian? Are you guys Canadian?
We're both Canadian. Tom hunts. We've got some deer mounts or some buck mounts on our, yeah, he's a bow hunter. And we have venison just stocked in the garage and we eat it all the time. It's great.
Awesome. Well, my point is, John, I think you're surrounded by the spirit blood brothers here tonight because
we
all
are.
The best.
Yeah.
All the best healing powers of nature, can you get it kayaking and just camping in a tent? To a great degree, you can. But actually function as a participant in God's miraculous wildlife creation, the animals must be balanced. Not everybody has to do it, but somebody does have to do it. And when you pull that trigger or loose that arrow and you bring that hard-earned game to bag, let me make sure I emphasize, I hear so often, well, I can see hunting for food, but not for a trophy. Every hunt is a trophy.
It's a trophy hunt.
Every animal is a trophy. You can't get food without a trophy. And when people wait for the giant stag that is the ultimate book trophy, they by law, laws that we pass and we pay law enforcement to enforce, they have to utilize that meat. It's against not to utilize that meat. So every hunt is fun because it's exhilarating. It's sport because it's challenging. You got to get through the woods and the swamp. It's always precious, sacred venison. And every hunt, even when you don't kill the animal, the trophy is those sunsets and sunrises and the campfire with your friends and family. So we're emphasizing that on the Spirit Campfire because we need to not only celebrate and promote conservation, but to educate people. And let me answer one question that I got on Facebook when I answered the question. Somebody posed it, why would you kill an elephant? Because you can't eat it.
Maybe
you can't eat it, but the natives in Africa, they rely on that protein. That's venison. It's just a lot of venison. But then they mentioned that they saw photos of animals, the elephants, with just their tusks taken off. That only happens where hunting is banned because there's no hunting dollars to pay for game wardens to make sure that that animal isn't disrespected. So if you want animals to die for no good reason at all, ban hunting because the dollars will disappear to hire law enforcement and biologists to make sure that we only harvest the sustained amount. So in every instance, when you see an elephant with the tusk cut off, I guarantee that was because there's no hunting allowed and there was no money to pay game wardens. So the poachers slaughter indiscriminately. So if you want to save wildlife, buy a hunting license. That's the best.
So I want to hear from Crispy and Tim Montana on your thoughts on being one with nature when you're out there.
You know, I think we're very extremely blessed, especially here in the U.S., because you can pick up your gun, your bow, and travel from Texas all the way up to Montana, back Wyoming, everywhere you want to go, and you can do it free. You know, if you go to other countries, there's no guns, you can't hunt, wildlife runs like crazy. But here in the U.S., we're able to do it. And like Ted said, if you don't want to hunt, buy a hunting license. You don't have to use it, but you're providing for all those things that he's just talked about. And people like me and Ted that take it very seriously, and it helps you, and it helps you grow, and you learn. I mean, there's lessons to be learned everywhere you go. And I can't tell you how many lessons I've learned from hunting elk, from hunting deer, or pigs. I mean, there's a lesson in everything, and you absorb that, and then you pass it on. I do a hunt with inner city kids out of San Antonio every year, and every year I sit down with three or four, and I share my stories about hunting and what I learned and what not to do, and I see these kids soaking it up, and it makes me so happy, and it recharges my batteries, because what I learned and what I experienced, it, I just put it in those little kids' lives, and they're going to use it, and they're going to talk about it, and they're going to spread the love and the treasure of hunting with others. So that's why I love it.
Hallelujah. For you, Tim Montana.
Well stated.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Tim Montana, share some. I mean, a lot of people, look, like I said, I didn't grow up hunting. I own firearms for self-defense, and I haven't gone hunting. I will go hunting, hopefully, with everybody who's around the campfire tonight.
Let's go.
You can break us in. You can break me in. But talk about growing up hunting or what you like to hunt.
Yeah. When I was a kid, man, hunting was not a sport. It was a necessity. It was like, if we got a tag, it was, we were really poor, and that was what we were eating. And same with my mom, same with her family. She'd get a tag, and, you know, and she would hunt as well, because that would keep the freezers full. But, you know, doing that as a kid and moving to the city, I started in Los Angeles, and I was like, oh my God, where do you hunt in Los Angeles? And then I ended up in Nashville. I'm like, this is a perfect mix between city and, but I didn't hunt for 5 or 6 years. I was in music, going to music school. And I was like, I don't want to lose that. So I got back into it. And down here, you got to typically find private land and whatnot. But my songwriting all is in the woods. Like my ideas, original ideas. I start walking in the morning, I'm humming things. I probably miss more deer because I get a hook in my head and I'm out there. Hey, 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 hey. Oh my God, there he goes. That's what I like. Talk. That's my church. I talk to God. I write songs. I figure stuff out. When I was a kid, I didn't have a lot of friends living so far out in the woods. The same thing. I just churn up ideas. I think that's how I became a songwriter. But now, cool thing is, I have 3 kids. I have a 4-year-old boy, 8-year-old boy, and a 12-year-old girl. And she used to really be into hunting. And now the city and her girlfriends at school have kind of gotten a hold of her mind. And I keep telling her, I'm like, hey, you're going to kill one deer. You're going to harvest it with me. We're going to process it together, and you're going to eat it. And she's like, okay, yeah, whatever. And this year she turned 12, and she told me the other day, I said, hey, we're going to do this hunter safety thing. And she goes, Dad, you've been saying that every year for years. And I'm like, Savannah, you're 12. Magic number, hunter's education. She doesn't want to do it, but I'm like, I don't know if you've seen the state of the world right now. I'm pretty sure you might need to know how to do this to survive at some point in your life. And that's going to be one thing your dad hands down to you, whether you like it or not. We're getting a deer.
Good for you, Tim. You're a great father, man. And that's a system by which you can keep kids who naturally, as they're getting into that age, they want to rebel and they want to go off on their adventures. But if they can just return to the earth and participate in God's nature and realize why Thanksgiving is in November, we're thanking God for his renewable pantry that feeds us and provides us clean air, soil, and water from the habitat that hunters. Yeah. Trappers manage. So Tim, well stated. Congratulations with your daughter, man.
Thank you.
Well, listen, Tim Jensen, I know that you have to run. I want to thank you so much for your support with Grunt Style. We hope that you can join us around the campfire and that we can continue to support Grunt Style and Grunt Style can continue to support us. We're about nothing but positive energy, and there's no better fit. And I can't thank you enough for all your help with Salute Across America. I can't thank you enough for sitting around the campfire and joining us.
Well, it's just a great opportunity to sit around with a bunch of great guys and gals that truly love our country and the bounties that it gives us every day. And I couldn't be prouder to be a part of that. So you guys have a wonderful evening, and we'll see you again next time.
That's right.
God bless you, man. Thanks for being a part of this. I hope to run into you again soon, man.
Shall do.
All right, so All right, so I wanted to continue this little country theme that we had going, and Molly and Tom really came up. I mean, I think they hit it out of the park with their first song, and I wanted to bring them back in, and let's see if we can bring Molly and Tom back in, because I think they have something else. What do you guys have for us?
Well, speaking of
hunting
and everything, well, we've got a song of yours, Ted, called A Thousand Knives. Ready?
Tom, what a killer treatment. Now, you got to admit, is that song fun to play or what?
It is.
Well, that, good for you. No, we started playing, I wrote that song, 40 years ago, but we started playing it on tour the last couple of years because it has such an infectious, you know, melody opening guitar line. And it, congratulations. Wow, I am honored that you would put that much of a soulful treatment to my old rock and roll song. Thank you very much. That was killer.
I'm so glad you like it. It's a hell of a song, and we're just happy to be able to play with it, right?
Yeah, thanks, Ted.
So, Ted, here's what's amazing to me. Now, however people relate to the universe, the great God above, however you want to refer to it, let's refer to it as God, is working through you to write a song that then the spirit of that song is transferred to Molly and Tom. They put their own spin on it, and that spirit is circling our campfire, that positive energy. I've never heard a rendition like that. And when you say, look, your old rock and roll version, it's such a beautiful song that you wrote. Ted Nugent wrote that song. It's so beautiful.
Well, thank you for that. You know, I'm surrounded by the world's greatest musicians in the world. I'm really impressed with Molly and Tom, because when you put your heart and soul into a musical statement, a musical adventure, a musical treatment, whether it's your own composition or somebody else's. We all play cover songs. We all play other songs. I used to play every James Brown and Wilson Pickett and Motown and Sam and Dave. I played all those songs Booker T and the MGs. And what you do is you learn your own voice, but no matter what voice that may be, no matter how esoteric or how unique or how off the wall, because that was a treatment to my song that had a specific melody and chord pattern, but it was so beautiful what you did to it. I think we can all agree, and not just unique to the Spirit Campfire, but to the World Campfire, that music is the universal communication. And no matter what your politics may be, what your ethnicity or your background or your walk of life or your dreams or ideas, we can all share what Molly and Tom deliver in music. And not just because it's my song, which makes me extra proud as the daddy to that song, but it's almost like my child went to your home and you came up and fed him really good. So a celebration. And I said it, I think, every campfire so far, but the words fail me, which almost never happens, to adequately describe my appreciation for the support and celebration of my music 40 million albums later, 60 years. I've been doing this for 62 years, and it's more intense and more gratifying today than it's ever been. So thank you for that, Molly and Tom, and thank you for everybody out there for supporting my music and the gushing love of this universal communication of music I experience on Facebook every day is just so humbling and so moving. That here's the problem, everybody. You're inspiring me to do even more. So here I
So Ted, in terms of perpetuating this positive energy, look, Tim Montana is well on his way to being a country superstar. You know, his last album did really well. He's in the studio now doing his next album. And Tim is really, really getting a ton of traction. Molly and Tom are at that position where they are incredible songwriters, incredible performers. How can we perpetuate positive energy and lift not only Tim and help him out, but how do we lift Molly and Tom as well?
Well, you know, nowadays it's a little different. I mean, the mantra of the 50s and 60s when I started playing was really experimental. There was no such thing as platinum albums or gold albums. I didn't know what a tour was. I just wanted to make music, even if it was in my basement or at the malt shop, literally. But nowadays it's become a social media phenomena. There really is no more record stores. There really isn't, for practical purposes, record companies and record people. Now it's live streaming and all this high tech stuff. So I would like to take all of Molly and Tom's musical creativity, and I'd like to put it on my website. I'd like to put Tim's on my website and on the Spirit Campfire, you know, websites and any other social media that we have, because you guys have obviously just stink of talent. You got the spirit, you got the soul. And believe me, having jammed with the Motown Funk Brothers when I was 13 years old, I know what the mountaintop of soulful music is, and you guys got it. And I would like to do everything in my power and my resources to help get that exposure. So number one, congratulations. We talked about this before, and I'm gonna repeat it. Your average person who loves the song and loves this artist and loves the music, they have no idea the work ethic of a musician, the sacrifices to do without practice and do without, barely have enough for new guitar string, and you don't get nothing, but you keep practicing, you got a job and then you practice. The work ethic of your success, or not even just, you know, commercially successful artists, but the work ethic of musicians is as strong as anybody that ever built a bridge or a dam, maybe more so. So Molly and Tom and Tim, salute for that, because I know the sacrifices and the risks that you guys have to take. So yes, John, I think we should help them out in any way that we can. I love your guys' attitude and I love your musical state.
Thanks, Uncle Tim. Amen.
Yeah, it's incredible. And honestly, what's been really fascinating to me is, as I've been sharing with everybody, the Spirit Campfire, and you know, when you say the Spirit Campfire with Ted Nugent, you know, literally, for those who don't know Ted well, for those who have only, you know Ted through his music and what everybody else is saying, I'm like, I don't know if I've met somebody as generous and as positive who wants everyone to win and succeed. I mean, that is what's so wonderful about this campfire, is the mere fact that we're just trying to perpetuate positive energy. And I promised Molly and Tom, when Tim Montana introduced us, I said, you know what? I want you to play for the world. I want you, there's going to be somebody who hears you that's going to be that tipping point. That's just, that person's going to forward the right link and it's going to go on and on and on. And Tim Montana's music, for those of you who are not familiar with it, check out Tim Montana. Just go to YouTube, look at the millions of hits that he already has, listen to his music, buy his albums, support musicians. It's such a weird world now of how musicians make money, but please go out and support Tim, support Molly and Tom. So, and listen, support Mr. Nugent. Buy Ted Nugent's music. Bring a whole new generation. It's amazing how, Ted, you're like, I've done this for 60 plus years. And I find what's amazing is it's that music has lasted. It has lasted. How in the world is something that you wrote 50, 60 years ago, how in the world is it still around as vibrant as ever?
I think work ethic and the fact that I always repeat that I've always been just blessed to be surrounded by other work ethic monsters. All my bandmates have been so talented, so dedicated, so willing to do that struggle, because musicians really do struggle. It really is a pain in the ass. When the Amboy dudes were doing 350 concerts a year and I had to drive the station wagon, we all slept in one Holiday Inn room for $9.95 a night. But the adventure in youth is so exciting, and that friction and the angst and the difficulty, you know, changing a tire at 4 a.m. in Dothan, Alabama on your way to Birmingham, it teaches you a work ethic and a never give up attitude. And the musicians that I've been surrounded with, I could name everyone starting in 1958. I know every musician I've ever collaborated with, and I've had nothing but the greatest talented monsters at my side. So yes, I authored the vast majority of these songs because I have a vision and I treat them like children, that these are my statements and it's got my name on it. And those are my lyrics and my chord changes and patterns. But the musicians that collaborated with me and performed on my music and also co-wrote some of them were just talented as anybody, from John Coltrane to Paul McCartney to Howlin' Wolf. I've had the greatest soulful, talented musicians at my side all my life. So I'm just damn lucky is what happened.
Yep. All right. I wanted to wrap up this campfire. I wanted to just do a quick round table here for closing thoughts. Molly and Tom, you got any closing thoughts?
Just blessed to be here. Thank you very much for having us, John. And
we're very blessed to be here.
Great to meet you, Ted. Good to see you, Omar. Awesome.
Yeah, it's always such a great time to be with everybody on this stream, and we appreciate it so much.
Cool.
And I just hope everybody's well.
And drink
Tim Montana.
Honored to be here. Blessed to be here. Uncle Ted, man. Enjoyed sharing the campfire with you. Can't wait to do it in person. And Crispy, man. Love you, brother. Good to see you. Can't wait to see you again.
Yeah, bro.
Ollie and
Crispy.
Tom,
you get,
by the way.
Yeah, Molly, Crispy, you got any closing thoughts for us?
You know, same thing as always, be good to one another, treat each other with respect, and show your neighbor some love, and just be a good human being.
Now, Ted, I know, Herbert, let's go full screen with the website that I just pulled up. I know you texted me earlier today and you told me that you wanted to make sure that we made sure that everybody was made aware about chancetowin.org.
Yeah, we have a great bunch of heroes of Delta Force and all the special operators out there, Special Forces Motorcycle Club Brotherhood. They're doing an auction for their fellow warriors, and I'm proud to be a part of it. It's the Special Forces Brotherhood Motorcycle Club auction, and you can get that at my Facebook. We try to promote that every day. But everybody just remember that freedom isn't free, and that we have this campfire, and we have this freedom to express ourselves with the First Amendment and the life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness that's unique to this part of the world. And it's because warriors made the ultimate sacrifice. And like Crispy, they came home with a lot of injuries, but they're proud and honored to do so because they know that they paved the way for the people to be the best that they can be. So never, never forget the heroes of the United States military and their families.
Absolutely. Well, listen, everybody, thank you so much for joining us around the campfire. You can go to thespiritcampfire.com. To buy some merchandise. Please go to tednugent.com to support Ted. Please check out Tim Montana. Check out Omar Avila. Check out Crispy on Instagram. Molly Brown, Tom Samulak. Also Grunt Style. Killcliffe. Make sure you support everything, because honestly, when we all band together, that positive energy continues to grow. So we're going to be back on Monday, 9 o'clock. I know that some people were commenting that Facebook was funky, but we will be posting this. We have a nice clean feed. We'll be posting it. Nice clean feed to everybody's Facebook page. All the YouTube feeds worked great. So if you didn't catch it live, you obviously will be able to watch it recorded. And listen, God bless everyone. You know, listen to Crispy, listen to this music, and listen to how we can just perpetuate positive energy. Nothing better than the Spirit Campfire in this positive energy. So God bless everyone.
The physics of spirituality with attitude. See you, Molly. See you, Tom. See you, Crispy. John, Godspeed, everybody. Live it up. Raise hell like you mean it.
My music. 40 million albums later, 60 years. I've been doing this for 62 years, and it's more intense and more gratifying today than it's ever.